prices led to a considerable reduction in domestic fuel prices.
Something new has come out of Africa. It is a highly scientific focus on something very old indeed, the Nguni breed of cattle. What are the historical and biological origins of this precious indigenous breed? What are their characteristics and commercial potential? What aesthetic and cultural factors are relevant to the preservation of the breed? This is a country of many biological wonders. Many of them undoubtedly have great untapped agricultural potential. Our scientists and our farmers are becoming increasingly aware of this. Many of them consider it a privilege to participate in fascinating research projects that may expose some latent resource that could influence or even determine our survival in the world tomorrow. It is through their enthusiasm that the calamity of the Nguni extinction will be averted and that the excellent remnant genetic material will be correctly managed and guided to develop into an important national asset. Ethno-archaeologist Henri Lehout, a specialist on Saharan prehistory and director emeritus of the French National Research Center, discovered and portrayed an important oasis of rock art in the middle of the Algerian Sahara. Here in a wadi or sheltered gully in the Tassili Plateau, prehistoric artists presented their interpretation of life around them 7,000 years ago. At that time, the Sahara was a well-watered grassland with an abundance of game and, in places, herds of cattle that were obviously domesticated. During the day in this scene, Bantu tribesmen kept the calves in enclosures while driving the cattle out to graze in the natural pastures. At night, the cows returned to suckle their young and to surrender a portion of their milk flow to their owners. The herders lived in caves in the rocky hillsides where they left archaeological material for us to interpret today. Chipped stones, clay pot shards, rock paintings, and the bones of man and prey. Henri Lehout considered their paintings to be the earliest historical record of African domesticated cattle. Flared oxtail leg and arm tassels worn by these pastoral herders 7,000 years ago on ceremonial occasions are still in fashion with the Bantu-speaking Zulu dancers of today. And so are the built-up hairstyles of their womenfolk. These clearly Negroid people are thought to have been the ancestors of the Bantu-speaking races of Africa. They lived in settled communities and had a distinct culture. They hunted game with stone implements, cultivated crops of millet and sorghum, baked pottery, and herded small, humpless cattle. It is possible that the cattle were not introduced from across the Mediterranean, but were indigenous to Africa. From the wild state, they could gradually have become more closely associated with man until they were permanently domesticated. By 3000 BC, the Sahara was drying out and game numbers were diminishing. The people became more dependent on their cattle and increased the size of their herds. Overgrazing resulted, and consequently, the desert spread. Where dune met pasture, the goats inevitably devoured the remaining bushes, and the desert forming process accelerated. The same is still happening in the Sahara today. Eventually, the people had to move, and they took their cattle with them. The greatest north-south migration in the history of Africa was set in motion.
Yeah.
When they encountered the Congo Tetsi Belt, they were forced to move east. There was a finality about the deadliness of Ngana as far as their cattle was concerned. They could not penetrate the forests, and consequently, their migration gravitated in the direction of Nubia and the Nile. Historians are quite sure of their facts concerning the growth of Egypt and its relations with the great Negroid kingdom of Kush on its southern borders. Paintings and written records in the monuments of Egypt indicated a flourishing cattle industry existed in both the lower and the upper kingdoms. This 15th century BC tomb painting shows small, humpless, shorthorned cattle of particularly interesting color patterns. This beautiful polled cow was wonderfully domesticated and a very good milker. This is a truly remarkable work of art. Egypt conquered Nubia in 1500 BC, and the Kushites were a prolific source of Negro slaves, cattle, gold, ivory, and iron. The Kushites, in turn, thrived to such an extent that they conquered Egypt in 750 BC. At about 500 BC, Semitic people entered Africa at the Horn and along the coast of the Red Sea. It is known that they were associated with the discovery of shipping and that they established new trade routes to Arabia. During this period, a previously unknown type of cattle entered northeast Africa. It had short horns and a distinct fatty hump situated over the shoulder, a clearly Zebu type. These Zebu imports were quite obviously thoroughly interbred with the cattle already there, and a new breed emerged, the African Sanga, a beautiful animal with a large muscular cervico-thoracic hump and unusually attractive color markings. It is reasonable to assume that a thorough mixing of the peoples also occurred since the Kushites were defeated about AD 350, and as a distinct race, they mysteriously disappeared from the northern hemisphere. Did this new race, the Nguni, an intermixture of Kushite, Hamitic, Semitic humanity move southwards? It was the only route open to them. Ethno-archaeological evidence clearly suggests that Bantu-speaking Nguni tribes with Sanga cattle moved down the grassy Ngana tree corridor of the highlands from Kenya through Tanganyika, Malawi, and Zambia, even through Zimbabwe, and they eventually arrived in Barotse land. They and their stock must have overcome stupefying obstacles of tropical climate and disease, insect pests, tribal warfare, and predatory animals on this southward migration. Only the functionally efficient could survive. Some Nguni and Soto tribes, with their respective strains of Sanga cattle, eventually swung east and south. South Africa's brilliant ethno-archaeologist, Elizabeth Voigt, estimates the arrival of the Sanga Nguni on our borders at between 590 and 760 AD. Excavations around the sacred mountain of Mapungubwe, 88 kilometers west of Messina in northern Transvaal, spotlight this fascinating development. It must, therefore, have been approximately 1,000 years ago that the migration was approaching its geographical destination. Some Embo Nguni tribes settled between the Usutu and the Tugela rivers. They had, figuratively speaking, arrived home. A promising future awaited them in their new homeland. Their iron smelting skills, successful hunting and fighting techniques, well-organized social structure had contributed toward their success. But a major factor to determine their survival was the fact that they possessed livestock on which they could depend. The Nguni race had developed into a warrior nation, feared throughout southern Africa. Oh, my God. the Nguni breed of cattle had developed into one of Africa's biological marvels, the envy of all who came in contact with them. And then came the European invader. How did he assess the value of indigenous cattle? The Khoikhoi Sanga, used by the Cape Frontier farmers, produced magnificent spans of Trek oxen, which served the pioneers remarkably well. But this wonderful beginning was never followed up with the Nguni Sanga on their arrival in Natal. On the contrary, breeds which were superb under European conditions were introduced regardless of their unsuitability to bushveld conditions. For a century, a great treasure, the completely adapted Nguni, was banned to the remote backwoods of Swaziland, Maputaland, and Zululand. The men who recently discovered them there, and who were responsible for rescuing a sufficient number to ensure viability by way of diversity of genetic material, deserve national recognition. The 19th century traveler, artist, and zoologist George French Angus painted this tranquil scene near the Umgeni in 1847. It shows cattle and the Zulu family in close relationship of languid and ambient contentment. For centuries, the Nguni people had herded them all day long and guarded them in stockades surrounded by their huts at night. The breed consequently developed a very docile temperament. Nguni cows conceive well and calve without difficulty. Their conformation is such that particularly the rump and sloping pelvis play an important part in ease of calving. Research statistics indicate a far lower calving interval than other breeds recorded in the experiment. Fertility records show a calving percentage well above the average. Heifers are early maturing and can produce a calf earlier than other breeds without suffering any growth setback. Because of their loose, thick skins, they are very tick tolerant. They secrete within their skin substance in serum which has a profound adverse effect on the ticks that attack them. The ticks either die or lay very few viable eggs, thereby contributing little to future tick populations. They also show a high degree of tolerance to tick-borne diseases, one of the main causes of stock losses in our country. Marketed directly off the felt at 18 months of age, net income far exceeds that of any other breed tested under similar conditions. From the cattleman's point of view, they cost little to keep and require little attention because they thrive in marginal areas and extend their utilization of what vegetation there is by browsing on a variety of nutritional trees. Under feed testing conditions, they show a growth rate that is competitive with the best. The carcass quality is excellent, a superior tastiness and tenderness with correct fat meat composition. Many people in South Africa today are concerned with the ecology of many of our productive stock-raising units. In the extensive, hot, dry, low-lying bushveld areas, there is substantial information which indicates that cattle plus wildlife, especially antelope, is a more viable enterprise than cattle only or game only. The combination is also more protective of the environment. In this situation, no breed of cattle can compete with the Nguni. This mural from one of the southern Egyptian monuments shows what picturesque color patterns their cattle had. If these cattle and the Eastern Zebu were indeed the precursors of the Sangha, then the genetics determining color were dominant to such an extent that they have been retained over the generations to the present day. In fact, the diverse color patterns present a visible indication of the genetic variation present in a herd, and they are an integral part of adaptation in adverse environments. We do know that Nguni pastoralists, for identification purposes, selected male breeding animals only on phenotype. Their main emphasis was on specific hide colors and variations of horn shape. The special importance the Zulu attached to his cattle is strikingly illustrated by the precise way in which the color of every beast in the herd was described with great exactness by specific terms. There are over 100 of these in their vocabulary. The majority of Swazi and Zulu Nguni cattle have pigmented hides and dark, if not black, hooves and muzzles. The fine, hairy coat shows a variety of colors which may appear as whole colors or as specific broken patterns. There are 6 whole colors: Mbomvu, red; Mpofu, yellow; Ndaka, dun; Mhlophe, white; Nsundu, brown; Nyama, black. This is the portrait of a cow found by Ted and Liz Riley in their remote Swaziland bush. The facial profile identifies the conformational features of the breed and serves as the symbol of the Nguni Breeders Society of South Africa. Her facial profile is straight and clean. The ears are lively, pointed, and fine of hair. There is no wooliness about the head. Her dewlap starts under the mandible, recedes at the throat, reappears and ends under the brisket. The skull. The skull or frontal bone is extended well above the eyes. The horn core or processus cornus emerges at right angles, and the horn is round or slightly oval. It curves gently back, then up, forwards, and forms a most attractive lyre shape. In females, the horn is of a fine, elegant quality and may vary in shape. Because of the importance of milk in their diet, the Zulu and Swazis always favored the good milkers. Small wonder that the ideal Nguni female is light of bone and conformationally typical of the smaller milk breeds. She is, however, capable of carrying a lot of beef. In this respect, she differs completely, for instance, from the Jersey. Note her weapon against troublesome flies and ticks: a strong, very long tail with a good switch. Her udder is compact and well placed, with 4 short, rounded teats not easily scratched by thorny bushes. Her milk production ensures an amazing weaning mass index in her calf. Note her excellent legs and hooves, capable of walking long distances. Pasterns are short and upright, hooves larger than other cattle and set close together. The Nguni calf is small, averaging about 27 kilograms at birth, and therefore calving problems are extremely rare. They are mobile almost from birth and are extremely hardy and active. This is a portrait of Nchali. His face is masculine and full of authority. His eyes are dark, with prominent protective musculature around them. His horns are much thicker and less curved than the female. They were meant for attack and defense. He has to maintain the territorial imperative of his herd, and any challenge to his domain is met with great courage and incredible speed and stamina. His large cervico-thoracic hump has the power to toss an attacking lion high up in the air for his strong horns to gore to death on landing. His thick, loose-muscled, controlled skin repels ticks. He's heat-tolerant and heals quickly when injured. His sheath is short and firm, and his testicles large and uniform in size, a minimum of 30 centimeters in circumference. He will serve his cow 3 times in 10 minutes and attend to a harem of 50 without losing condition or missing out on a single one. In spite of this, he is placid and easily manageable. Indeed, the mature, well-bred Nguni bull is one of the triumphs of nature. The most famous and guarded by the Zulu nation of all their cattle was the King's Zulu royal herd. Even today, an aura of prestige and symbolism is attached to them. When Shaka became king in 1818, he built his kraal on the right side of the Modi stream, a tributary of the Mkobani, and called his new headquarters Bulawayo. Shaka was a man of fine taste. So wanting exceptional cattle, he crossed the Mtanjineni Heights and visited his distant relative, Maslakovu, of the Magandini clan of Mfuli. This chief was in possession of some greatly admired cattle. They were white with black muzzles and ears. Shaka requested a present and was given 6 heifers, 1 ox and 1 bull. With these, he bred up his subsequently famous white herd known as the Inyoni Kaipumuli, the bird that never rests. All cattle in Zululand of similar color were considered his property, and soon a herd of hundreds were kept in the precincts of the royal kraal. So proud were subsequent kings of Zululand of their royal herds that the only regiments allowed to make shields from their hides were the famous veterans, the White Shields. Here, Angus has captured the drama of King Mpande reviewing his Black Shields, the young warriors, and his favorites, the White Shields. Approximately 12,000 of these beautiful animals roamed the hills of Zululand up to the time of Cetshwayo's coronation, when all the cattle of the kingdom passed before him. It was during this period that the royal herd contracted the dreaded lung disease from infected herds, and soon half of them were dead. The royal herd was offered by Cetshwayo to Lord Chelmsford as a peace offering after the Battle of Ginganclove on the 2nd of April, 1879. But these were turned back by several angry chiefs and the king's most loyal regiment, the Umtiejo. The herd was dispersed to the four corners of Zululand. After the Battle of Ulundi on the 4th of July, 1879, the royal herd was confiscated and the royal kraal of Ondini burnt to the ground. John Dunn made an attempt to save some of these noble animals by buying them in order to rescue them from being butchered. He returned a few to the next monarch, King Dinuzulu. Miraculously, a small gene pool survived, and from the remnants purchased in the remote bush at Mumfini by the Natal Parks Board, a new herd was slowly built up at Midmar. His Majesty King Goodwill of Zwelithini is the 8th reigning Zulu monarch of the House of Shaka. He is a living model of Western sophistication on the one hand, but he also plays an inspired role in the preserving Zulu national consciousness and culture. The fauna and flora of Zululand, and especially the Nguni cattle that played such an important role in the socio-economic and religious aspects of his ancestors, are very close to his heart. He has built up a picturesque herd, but it was on the 13th of June, 1989, that one of his ambitions was realized when the Natal Parks Board presented him with the nucleus of a breeding herd of the true Zulu royal cattle. The bird that never rests has once more been restored to royal hands and royal lands. A small herd of beautiful Shaka cattle are home again.